Please welcome Masha Gessen. Welcome to Stockholm.
Thank you. Great to be
here. You're here as a guest of honor on the Grand Swedish Journalism Prize, right?
Right, and that's tonight.
Yes. And we're so glad that you've found the time to come here first.
It's great to be here.
Your book is, in a way, defining Vladimir Putin for the rest of the world, but it's because it's out in very many countries, but not Russia.
Right, it's a very strange feeling and a very strange story because the book came out in about 20 countries in the spring, around the time that he was re-elected for a third term as president, and has not come out in Russia. So there are two bookstores in Moscow that carry it in English, but basically no one in Russia has read it, you know, with the exception of a couple of dozen people.
And have you tried to have it published in Russia? Or?
I have tried. There was a publisher that was interested and got scared that they would get shut down for tax violations or something. They would find something wrong with the publishing house if they published the book. So they didn't publish the book, and they still got shut down for tax violations.
To be a journalist and a writer in Russia today, it's not really a risk-free job. It's quite risky, actually. Can you try to describe the situation?
Well, you can look at the statistics. It's one of the most dangerous places to be a journalist. And it's probably the most dangerous of any countries that are at peace. So it's like being a war correspondent all the time, which is really not a good feeling. I used to be a war correspondent, and the nice thing about being a war correspondent is that you go there and then you leave, and you're safe. In Russia, journalists are always at risk.
Have you been threatened? Have you had friends threatened or colleagues threatened? Or?
I get death threats almost every day. At the same time, you know, I don't feel particularly concerned or particularly scared, partly because you can't live with fear all the time, but partly because I haven't had anything bad happen to me in a few years. The worst thing that happened to me was my computer was stolen, clearly by the security services, but still.
But when you have these threats, what kind of threats are they?
People email me, people call me, people write me on Facebook. And it is pretty much a daily occurrence. But other people I know have, in fact, been beaten and attacked, and some people have been killed.
You are, as I understand, also an American citizen.
So, yes, I am.
So you could, if you wanted, choose to live in America and write from America. But you live in Moscow with your family, with children.
Right.
Why do you choose that?
It's my home. I like it there. He should leave and I should stay.
I also read you have this theory about there is a difference between traitors and enemies. What is that theory?
It's not actually my theory. It's very much of a KGB trope, basically, that the worst people are not your enemies. That you know your enemies, you know who they are, you know they're predictable. The worst people are the traitors, the ones who used to be friendly and then became critics. And if you look at Putin's behavior, he's certainly gone after, and the machine has gone after the so-called traitors much more cruelly than it has gone after the so-called enemies. And Alexander Litvinenko, the former FSB agent who was poisoned by polonium in London, is certainly the most striking, the most horrible example.
So you would be considered an enemy and not a traitor?
I hope so. I'm certainly not a friend.
How would you describe him, Putin? And he's not here to defend himself, of course. but how would you describe him as a leader?
Actually, I'm not sure how to describe him as a leader because I don't think he's much of one. I would describe him as a very vengeful, very small man, who is extremely aggressive and has trouble controlling his aggression. And actually, my description is not particularly original. This is how he describes himself. I mean, you know, Putin had a very strange story, which is that he had no public record when he became president. So he could tell the world what he wanted the world to know about him. He could write his own story, and the story he chose to write was the story of somebody who was a thug, who as a kid was always getting into fights, and kept going after the person that he got into a fight with, even after the conflict seemed to be resolved. And again, as somebody who's extremely vengeful.
So he came from nowhere in a way. And I mean,
well, he came from the KGB, which is a little bit like nowhere.
But it's almost like nowhere because he was not a well-known person.
Right, right.
What would you say is his driving force?
You know, that's an interesting psychological question because I think he really does truly believe that he and Russia are now one and the same. And that when he is attacked by, say, the protesters in the streets, then those are attacks on Russia. He sincerely thinks so. And he also thinks that those who attack the regime and, he thinks, attack Russia can't be real Russians. They have to be foreigners or they're funded by foreigners, which is why there's been this real intensification in Russia of the siege mentality and siege rhetoric where, you know, whoever is not with us is against us. And it's probably a foreign agent, which is a term that they're using now, which is very much like the term enemy of the people in the 1930s. So I think he thinks exactly what he's been telling people, which is that the country is on the brink of collapse, that it's surrounded by enemies, it's a really scary world, and he's the only person who can hold it all together.
He's also, as I understand, a very rich man. I mean, it's been a lot of speculations here, but according to some numbers, he's the richest man in the world.
I think that's very likely.
How did that happen? How is that possible?
He likes to take things that are not his. Often, quite literally, if he likes something, he takes it.
Would you say that Putin is a man of the old Russia, the old-fashioned Russia, instead of the modern Russia?
He's very much a man of the Soviet Union, and I would go even further. I'd say he's a man of the KGB. I think he sincerely thinks that the KGB is the best thing that ever happened in the world and that everything should resemble the KGB, and he's built a country that looks very much like the KGB. One of the problems with it, however, is that it looks very much like the KGB of the 1980s when the country was already starting to disintegrate. So it's a very dysfunctional organization. It's an organization that used to create mountains of paper that nobody read and that missed Matthias Rust, the German pilot who landed his private plane in Red Square in the 1980s. And I think the country in which we live today is very much like that KGB. It's active, it's repressive, it's aggressive, and it's really dysfunctional.
You must have met Putin.
Well, yes, I met him, but he has not met me. We were several people visiting Moscow. We were politicians, and we were brought to see him. But we shook hands, and of course he was nice to us. But we did not have a genuine political debate. So I shook hands with him, but that's all.
Did you meet his predecessors?
Both of them.
Yeltsin and
Gorbachev.
Gorbachev.
Gorbachev, I feel I know. Mm-hmm. And I even feel that he will remember my name because we lived in the same house outside Göteborg. We were guests of the Swedish government on a speaking tour in Europe. But we lived in the same house outside Göteborg when we were in Göteborg. And I got to know both him and Raisa, his wife, well during that time.
And what about Yeltsin? Was he sober?
Well, then I must tell you, this is two versions. Because my
Karin's
wife...
Karin's
and since I have this direct contact, I must tell you both versions. I believe that he shook hands with me and clapped me on the shoulder and asked me to send the greetings to the Norwegian correspondent Steinfeld. But Karin said that's nonsense. He only shook hands with you. It took you 2 or 3 minutes. But my version is, after all, more attractive.
But what was it in the Kremlin? But what do you think about what Marsha is telling us here?
Well, I haven't read your book. Mm-hmm. But I have one question to you and many others like you who I meet. Who will be the alternative to Putin today? Because I feel I met so many of the first Soviet and then Russian politician, that I feel you could write a worse book about some others, and I don't like to have them. Right. That's my question.
Well, in the last 12 years, what Putin has done is he's destroyed all political institutions, all electoral institutions, and the media. So we don't have a public debate in our country. We don't have a way to tell who the potential leaders are. So what we need when there's regime change, and I'm sure there will be regime change, is first we need a technocratic government that could be run by somebody like Alexei Kudrin, the former finance minister, that would rebuild the institutions. Mm. And then we'll see people emerge, and I'm sure they will emerge.
Yeah. You actually, you got to meet Putin.
Yes, I did.
How was that? Was it in the Kremlin?
It was in the Kremlin, yeah.
How was it to meet him?
It was very strange because, of course, I've written a book about this man. I spent years listening to every speech he ever gave, watching every videotape ever made. So I had a relationship with him, very much like you had met him and he hadn't met you. And I had a relationship with him and he'd obviously never heard of me, which is also interesting.
He
doesn't know about the book. And he doesn't know who I am.
He still doesn't know, probably.
I don't think he does. I don't think it does. Because here's the thing. For him to know about the book, somebody would have had to tell him. And nobody wants to tell him about the book.
So you didn't bring him a book?
I didn't bring him a book because my family told me that they would chain me to a radiator if I took the book with me. I was hoping to see something that was different than I imagined. Honestly, I was hoping for a bit of a personal connection, even though it was a strange thing to hope for. But once you've had a relationship with somebody for years, you want to get something out of it. And there was nothing. He was very happy to talk. He clearly wasn't thinking about what he was saying. And he clearly wasn't thinking about who he was talking to. And that really showed just how isolated he's become.
So he just wanted to meet you because you were a well-known journalist?
No. What had happened was that I had become the editor of a popular science magazine, the largest and oldest magazine in Russia. And I was editing the magazine. It was this little sort of quiet place for me to be because it's not possible to do political reporting in Russia anymore. And then the magazine became one of those things that Putin wants to own, even though it doesn't belong to him. So there was an agreement that the magazine entered into a partnership with an organization that Putin chairs, which is the Russian Geographic Society. And then Putin decided to fly a hang glider to lead the Siberian cranes to a new migratory route. And I was told to send somebody with Putin to cover it. And I refused, because I wanted to write about the cranes without writing about Putin. And also because I didn't want to be in a ridiculous position, because something bad was going to happen, because something bad always happens when Putin tries to do something good. And then we'd be in a position where we had to decide whether to print it or not. But once we'd seen it, we wouldn't be able to not print it without giving up the profession. So I said to my publisher, we're better off not seeing this at all. And he said, in that case, you're fired. So I wrote on my Twitter feed that that I had been fired because I refused to go with the cranes and Putin. And the next day, Putin called me.
He called you personally?
He called me personally, on the phone. And in fact, when he called me, I was... this was the day after I was fired. So I was feeling a little hungover. and he called me. My phone rang, and somebody said, hold on. And I held on for 2 minutes, and then somebody else came on the line and said, and I was getting really mad that I was holding on for 2 minutes for no reason. And somebody else came on the line and said, don't hang up, I'm about to connect you. And I started shouting. I didn't ask to be connected to anybody. Why don't you just introduce yourself? And somebody said, Putin Vladimir Vladimirovich. So the first thing that happened was that I screamed at him and he introduced himself. And he said that he'd heard that I had been fired because of him. And would I come to the Kremlin and talk to him about nature conservation?
So that was the topic of the conversation?
That was the topic of the conversation.
But was he did you find, I mean, did he have any charm at all?
No, you
didn't. And was he, how did he look? How was he different than you had thought, or?
Well, you know, he's looked very bloated in the last few years. It seems to be connected to plastic surgery, but this is speculation. But he, you know, his face looks very different. And so he looked bloated.
I see. A bit like Lenin these days.
I didn't say that.
Oh, I didn't say it either, actually. Marsha Gessen, thank you so much for coming here. I know you have to go, but we'll keep you here a little longer anyway.
I'd love to stay.
Hans, please welcome Bruno Mars.